number 159. If you'll take your hymnal and turn there with us, 159. Those that can, let's stand together and sing it together. First, second, and the last, blessed be the name of the Lord. All praise to Him who reigns above in majesty supreme, who gave His Son for man to die, that many might man redeem. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name.
Standing for prayer, if you would please. Brother David Foster is coming to pray for us, so let's pray together at this time. Brother David.
Amen. Heavenly Father, your name is surely wonderful to us tonight. Amen. You're worthy to be praised. Yes. And we just thank you, Lord, so much, dear God. We thank you for the services this morning, dear Lord. Yes. And how you spoke to our heart. And but this is another service here, and God, we pray, Lord, tonight that we might all get our hearts and minds set upon thee tonight. Yes. Lord, and yes. We pray, dear God, that you might have your way in every aspect of the service, Lord. Yes. We thank you for your blood that you shed so freely for us. Yes. We pray, dear God, if there be one here that's not under your blood, Lord, that you would just deal with their heart tonight, and may they come and receive you as their Savior.
Yes.
Bless our preacher as he comes, dear God, and be there with the rest of the singing and the special singing. Mm-hmm. We give you this, all the honor to you, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Brother David. You may be seated. Listen as the choir sings, "When I've Traveled My Last Mile."
Thank you. 173. Love lifted me. Let's stand again and sing it, all three stanzas.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me, now safe am I. For love lifted me, the love lifted me.
Fellowship time. The ladies are playing. The choir's coming down. Turn around and shake hands with those around you. Fellowship one with the other, if you would, please.
Thank you for coming to church tonight. We appreciate you being here. How many of you would rather be here than in jail? Let's see your hands. How many of you? Almost everybody. Any of you ever been in jail? Let's see your hands. One little girl over here, she's been in jail, and two or three others here. Yeah. Some of you should have been, I'll tell you that much. Brother Michael Whitby has an announcement he wants to make about the Awana program for us. Brother Michael.
many of you all know because many of you work in Awanas, but some of you may not. One of the big events that we have every year in Awanas that the kids really have a good time on is a fall festival, a fall fun night we have. This year we're going to have it in about 4 or 5 weeks from now. And what we really need is some people outside of the persons that work every week in Awanas to take over either a couple or individual persons to take a booth and to really help us out with that night. And what I want to do is anyone who's interested, if they can, come and meet. And all we're going to do tonight is just get your name, so it won't take more than a minute or two tonight right after church. And we'll get your name and phone number, and then we can contact you and let you know what the events are going to be and how we can really pull this thing together. And we really would appreciate your help because this is a really big event for the kids. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. Where are we going to meet at, Michael? Up front here? Okay. So Wednesday night was the first night of our Awana program this year, and we had over 100 children, 12 years of age and under, just on a Wednesday night, and that's wonderful. All right, we're going to pray for our military and for our president. And I want to mention again, Dusty Hill hit a car bomb went off in Baghdad, and he's seriously hanging on to life in the hospital. And I want you in particular to remember him, plus all of them. We won't be able to help, but you have to pray for our military, pray for our president, pray for our leaders. If you'll stand with me, we'll do that. Robert Langford is going to come and pray for us tonight.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray in the holy name of Jesus to thank you, Father, for Jesus and for thy guiding hand and for the provision that you supply every day. We pray, Heavenly Father, for our military, those men and women who are putting their life in harm's way so that we might have the safety and peace that we have in this country. We've heard it said, Lord, that freedom is not free, but our hearts go out to these families who have lost loved ones, Father. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you would comfort them, Lord, as only you can. And help us, Heavenly Father, to understand that, unfortunately, being humans, things like this are totally necessary. There are evil people in this world, Heavenly Father. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that you'd deal with them according to your will. We pray also, Heavenly Father, for our president. Lord, we thank you that we have a man who knows you in the highest office in this country. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that as he gathers with his staff every morning, Lord, and seeks wisdom from you, Lord, that you would impart so much wisdom to him, Heavenly Father, and help our military leaders. Bless them, Heavenly Father, that they do the right things and say the right things and go to the right places when they need to. We cannot win anything, Lord, if you're not in it. But, Heavenly Father, the victory is already won because we have you in our battles. Bless this service tonight, Heavenly Father. Bless my pastor. Speak to him and through him. For we ask it in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Brother Langford. You may be seated. We can get our young men to come this evening. We'll receive the offering at this time. And, if we can get some fellows to help us, we'd appreciate it very much. Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me ask the Lord to bless the offering this evening. Father in heaven, thank you again for this day, this service now. Would you please continue to bless it and this portion of it? Would you bless this offering, use it for your honor and your glory? And again, as it has been prayed a number of times already today, but once again, Lord, would you help my preachers? You'll come here in just a few minutes. And bless the preaching of your word. Meet each need now, I pray, in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen. May the Lord bless as we give tonight.
if I can have your attention just for a second. The offering this evening, the Sunday night offering, preacher's already mentioned this, we had over 100 children here this past Wednesday night in our Awana program. Many of these kids are kids that are not able to afford their books nor their shirts, and we'd like to help them as a church family. So the Sunday evening offering, our mission offering from our children, is going to go toward that purchase, for that cause, I should say, for the purchase of books and shirts for those that cannot afford them. So if you could help in any way, it would be greatly appreciated. I'd just like toward that. If you'll hold it up as the children come by, they can pick that up and bring it and put it in our mission offering this evening. So children, you can come at this time, and if you have a scripture verse you want to say tonight or a song you want to sing, we'll let you do that as well. And boys and girls, anybody you see holding some money up and waving it at you, you go by and get it, pick it up and bring it and put it in the offering this evening. All right, God bless you. Thank you, ladies. Thank you, ladies. All right. Happy Ellie? No? Okay. All right, Aaron.
I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Psalms 129:14.
Amen. Good job. Joshua.
Get the new book from the old book. Get the new look from God's word, the inward look, the outward look, the upward look from the old book. Get the new look from the old book. Get the new look from God's word.
Amen. Good job. Come here, Bryson.
Darla Shepherd, you shall not want.
Amen. Good job.
19. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, for whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have eternal life. For whosoever his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already, because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil.
Amen. That's a good job, Morgan. You want to try it again? No? I'm just going to stand up here? All right, let's give all of them a big hand tonight. Wonderful job, children. And the children may be dismissed to go downstairs to their class at this time, 2 through 5 years of age. can be dismissed to go downstairs at this time. Coming to sing just before the message, Courtney Sanders, and she's singing You Were There.
chapter 17, please.
Courtney.
John 17. Find verse number 6 with me. For several weeks we've been preaching on the prayers of Christ. Several months. I'm just about halfway through, I guess. There's just so much to say about Christ praying. And John chapter 17 is the longest prayer that he prayed. It's an entire chapter where Christ prayed. I'm going to read verses 6 through 12 tonight. So if you'll bear with me as we read those, please. Look with me at John 17, verse number 6. I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou gavest them me, and they have kept thy word. Now they have known that all things whatsoever thou hast given me are of thee. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them that which thou hast given me, for they are thine. And all of mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee, Holy Father. Keep through thine own name those whom thou hast given me, that they may be one as we are. While I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. Let's keep reading. And now I come unto thee, and these things I speak in the world, they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them thy word, and the world hath hated them, because they're not of the world, even as I'm not out of the world, but thou shouldest keep them from the evil. They're not of the world, even I'm not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so have I also sent them into the world. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they may also be sanctified through the truth. Please help me be a blessing to your people. We need your help. We need your power. We need your presence. Speak to every heart, I pray, with thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. Last week in verses 1 through 5, we talked about Christ praying for himself. Tonight, we're talking about Christ praying for you and for me. I'm not going to sing. I'm sorry. I told her I was going to sing, but I'm not. I'm sorry, Gina. I looked over and saw her sitting over there. I may, after a while, I may need to get out of the mess I'm in right now. I'm sorry, Gina. Forgive me. Tonight, I'm going to talk about Christ praying for you and for me. I just happened to notice tonight, maybe it happens quite frequently, that how many people, when they pray for their preacher. Isn't it good to have people praying for you? Doesn't it make you just feel wonderful that say, I'm praying for you, well, I've been praying for you, you're on my heart, you're on my mind. Things tonight about Jesus, watch this now, he's praying for you. Just put a circle around yourself tonight. I'm talking no one in this room except just you. That Christ is praying for you. Isn't it interesting that this is the prayer that Christ prayed right before he goes to die on a cross? You know who he's focusing on? He's focusing on others, because that's his entire life. Even when he's dying, he takes time to save a thief and make sure his mother has a place to live, because Christ is always thinking of others. I'm glad for that, aren't you? I'm glad that he is. In this prayer, it's more of an instruction than a prayer, and only about two or three parts of this sermon tonight is going to be actually about the prayer, but it's about instructions. For number one, he tells the disciples how he schooled them. Would you look, please, with me at verse number 6? He said, I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. He said, Lord, I have made known to these men you've given me about your name. Christ is no greater teacher than Christ was, but that's not the reason he came, not to only be a teacher, but he came to die for our sins. But Christ taught us with authority and not like the scribes and the Pharisees. The subject he taught them was thy name. Look at verse number 6. He said, I have manifested thy name unto them. So he taught them, but he taught them on the subject of his name. Watch this for a second. And boy, this is so important. I want you to remember this in a few minutes. It'll come important to you. He told them about his attributes, his character, and his work. No wonder the devil hates an education that's based upon the Word of God, because it is an attack against the godly principles of which God wants us to learn as his people. That's why many of us want to step in our society to ban the words "In God We Trust" on our money, to ban from us pledging allegiance to one nation under God. But still yet, the Bible says that the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. The subject, the schooling, the students are those people which he's given to him. He's given us the Holy Spirit. He's teaching us. Now, how does he teach us? Well, I want to get to this, and you just bear with me for a few minutes. He teaches us through the Scriptures, the Word of God. Look what he said in verse number 8. He says, "For I have given them the," what? "The words." So the lessons that he taught us is he teaches us through the Word of God. Watch this for a second. God gave us his Son. Would you say amen to that? God gave his Son in sacrifice. Would you say amen to that? God gave us the Holy Spirit. Would that be a good place to say amen? But God also gave us the Scriptures. And we have the privilege of having the Word of God as a valuable gift. Amen? Aren't you glad, Adolfo, in your language you have a copy of the Word of God? Aren't you glad in your language you have a copy of the Word of God? What God has to say to us? There's 3,000 languages in the world that doesn't have a copy of the Word of God. We're a privileged people to have God's Word. It's valued. It's more valuable than TV Guide. It's more valuable than the Wall Street Journal. It's more valuable than sports magazine or a women's magazine. It's a privilege to have the Word of God given to us. And I'm just telling you, this is my source of strength, ladies and gentlemen. This is what helps me when I get down. When I get God's Word and I look at it, open it, it gives me help when no one else can help me. It speaks to me when no one else can speak to me. You ought to make it a vital part of your life. The privilege of the Word of God. Look in verse number 17. There's the purity of the Word of God. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy Word is what? Truth. Christ gave testimony of the purity of the Word of God. Science gives testimony oftentimes to the accuracy of the Word of God. Historians affirm the truths of the Word of God. Thirdly, under this point, we have the persecution of those who love the Word of God. Look at verse number 14 with me, please. He said, I have given them thy Word, and the world hath what? Hated them. We hold what this Bible to be true. We hold this Word of God to be honest and correct, and his precepts to be right in all things. Now, there's the schooling. It's the Scriptures he schools us with. And then he wants us to know that we are stewards of what he's given us. Look with me at verse number 6 with me again. He said, I have magnified or manifested thy name to the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they are, and thou gavest them to me, and they have kept thy word. And what God is trying to teach us here is there are several things that we do with God's Word. Let me show you, if I could, just briefly, and I'll get to what I want to talk with you about tonight. This is all introduction. Verse number 8. For I have given unto them thy words which thou gavest me, and they have done what? They have received them. The first thing you do with the Word of God is you receive it. Listen to me just for a second. If you're watching by television, listening by radio, under the sound of my voice tonight, you're not going to get saved till you're willing to receive what God has to say about it. Receiving it as being God. This is, listen, folks, I am preaching tonight, and I am the voice that God's talking with tonight, and I hope you hear his voice and not my voice. But I want to tell you something. When we are to receive the Word of God as it is indeed the Word of God and not the Word of men. This is God's Word, we're to receive it. Look at verse number 6, he says, and they have kept thy Word. Not only receive the Word of God, we're to obey the Word of God. Is that right? In verse number 8, he says, verse number 8, for I have given them the words that thou gavest me. We're to receive it. We're to believe what God said. Verses 7 through 8, I don't have time to even deal with these tonight. We're to grow in the Word of God. He says, they've known me. They've come to know me. We come to know him through the Word of God. And listen, watch this verse. Look with me in verse number 10 with me, please. He said, all are mine are thine, and thine are mine, and I am glorified in them. He's wanting us to know that how we treat the Word of God is how we treat him, because God is the Word in flesh. And I glorify him by glorifying his Word. Now, I said all that to come to where I need to come tonight. He's prayed this in his prayer for them. In verse number 9, look what he says, I pray for them. You can put that down. Jesus Christ is praying for you. There are some people excluded from this prayer. Look at verse number 9. He says, I pray not for the world. He's not praying for unsaved people here. He's praying for his children. He's not just praying for his disciples here. He's praying for those that believe on him. Now, we know this for a truth. We give you two verses of the scriptures. Romans 8:34, he's interceding for us. Hebrews 7:25, he ever lives to make intercession for us. But I want to show you a little verse tonight that we've not looked at yet in this study, in 1 John. Can you find 1 John with me, please? Find 1 John. And every Baptist ought to smile on a Sunday night when they read this one. 1 John 2. Have you found verse number 1? 1 John 2:1. My little children, so God said, I don't want you to sin. Is that what he said? Yeah. He says, and if any man do what? Is that a possibility for all of us? Is that a probability for all of us? If any man sin, what happens? We have an what? Advocate who with? Who is the advocate? Jesus Christ. Hey, watch this. Jesus Christ who? The righteous. All right, now here's what's going to happen. How many of you know this? That after you get saved, it doesn't mean you're perfect. I remember after I first got saved that I didn't watch television for a whole week. I just thought, you know, okay, I'm saved now. You know, I thought when I first got saved, I thought everybody wanted to get saved. You know, everybody want to want this message. Is wonderful knowing Christ. And I just know how terrible I felt when I did something wrong. And I thought, my goodness, that I slipped. And I did that, or I said that, or I did that. And the terrible feeling that was inside of me. Now, watch this for a second. I didn't have to get saved again. Amen? And what I have Jesus Christ, who's my advocate, my lawyer, that pleads my case with the Father. You understand that? And it's Jesus Christ, the righteous. And what God does, he sees me, when he looks at me, and thank God for this, he sees me as he sees his own son. When, oh my goodness gracious alive, I just got to give this to you. I can't wait till next week to hear this to you. John 17:23. Look at it with me a second. I'll tell you, the first time that verse ever hit me, I tell you, I don't know how I explained to you how I felt. Watch this for a second. Look at this, John 17:23. I and them, and thou and me, that they may be made perfect in one, listen to this, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me, watch this, and hast loved them as thou hast loved me. You know what he said? He said, God said, listen, God said, I love you as much as I love my own son. Hang that out somewhere. Love lifted me. Amen. I have an advocate with the Father. Jesus Christ, the righteous, he pleads my case for me. Amen. All right. Here's what he prays for. That's a supplication for us. He's our advocate. He's the one who prays for us. Watch this now. Watch this. This is the best part. These next 5 minutes are the best part, I think. And the rest of it, we're just going to put a pigtail on the end of it and wind up. This is the pork. You ready? I wish I could give this to you like I got it. Verse 11, John 17:11. And now I am no more in the world, but these are in the world, and I come to thee. Holy Father, come in the next word, safety. I want you to, through thy name, through thy holy name, read it thine own, that the character of God, when you mention his name, is at stake over the keeping power of his children. If God lost one of his own, his name would be ruined. Is that what it says? Wow! Do you understand that? Listen to me. It means you're okay. If you're in Christ, you're fine.
Now, I'm not saying you don't need to get some things in your life straightened up. I'm not saying you shouldn't get closer, but I'm just saying, as far as his keeping power, that it's up to his name. And I want to tell you, God is going to make his name will be exalted forever, and to praise the Lord forever. Listen to me for a second. My salvation and my spending eternity in heaven does not depend on my good works. It depends upon his name. He promised it. Amen? My home in heaven doesn't depend upon my baptism. It's not in baptism. He did it by his name. Amen? And my salvation is not upon my own goodness or my own works or anything else. It's upon his name. And whatever he's promised, he's able to do. Whew. I give them eternal life. They shall never perish. You see, then pluck them out of my hand. My Father which gave them, he's greater than all. And no man's able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. God cannot lie. I've given to them eternal life. All of those been justified are going to get glorified, whether you like it or not. That's what he said, Romans 8. For a second. Look with me at 2 Timothy. Not enough to make you smile? Okay, good. Make you give a holy grunt, won't it? 2 Timothy chapter 2. Here's the verse of scripture that our Awana workers people learn. 2 Timothy 2:15. Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. But shun profane and vain babblings, for they will increase unto more ungodliness. And their word will eat, this kind of words do, that profane and vain babblings, they'll eat as of the canker, whom is Hymenaeus and Philetus. Those two men have denied the faith. Here's what they've said. Who concerning the truth they've erred, and they've been saying the resurrection is past already, and they've overthrown the faith of some. Some people have listened to the words of these men, to the words of God, and they said that the resurrection has already taken place. Thank God. What's verse number 19? What's the first word say? Nevertheless. It doesn't matter what they say. Nevertheless, the foundation of God standeth sure. Amen. Having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. God put a seal on it. You know, I was reading yesterday or Friday that I hadn't even thought of that. I read this verse again about the importance of seals on things. Now, just think for a few seconds. Mordecai, the seal on that paper that killed the Jews because of Haman. Think of the seal that they gave the Roman people to take Paul to Rome to have him killed. There was a seal on papers. Think of the seal they put on that stone that was trying to keep Jesus inside the grave. Remember the seal? Hey, but you know why they used so many seals? Watch this for a second. Boy, this will bless your heart. They used the seal because so many people of that day couldn't read or write, but they could recognize a seal. You put that seal on something, and they could recognize it. And I want to tell you something, my salvation doesn't depend on my intelligence. It depends upon him who sealed us with the Holy Spirit of promise unto the day of redemption. Amen? I'm sorry. Just let me run on. Let me chase this rabbit for a sec. It's a good rabbit. We'll catch it. We'll stew it. You'll love it. I've told this story so many times, I'm almost embarrassed. But it's one of my favorite illustrations about our security in Christ. And you've heard it so many times, I already give it a number and we're just going to carry on. If I'd go ahead and tell it, I'd done been over with, all right? I love the story. Just love it. But in the Old Testament times, whenever they brought a sacrifice to the priest to be offered, they'd bring them morning and evenings. That a man would go out and he'd go to his flocks and he'd take him a certain lamb. He had to look at that lamb and he'd bring that lamb and give it to the priest because it was an offering for his sins. And here's what would happen. That priest would do this. Watch this. That priest would take the lamb. He'd always check the lamb. He never checked the man. As long as the lamb was all right, the man was all right. And I want to tell you, the Lamb of God was offered for you and I. And the lamb, as long as the lamb's all right, yeah, come on. Are you with me? As long as the lamb's all right, we're all right. Is that right? Isn't that wonderful? Because that's where we stand. That's where we are. Now, can I tell you that there was an exemption to the safety, but not to the security? Watch this for a second. Let's see. Look at verse number 12. When I was with them in the world, I kept them in thy name. Those that thou gavest me I have kept, and none of them is lost, but the son of perdition, the scripture might be fulfilled. God has not failed. Judas was a false disciple. Did you know there's nowhere in the Word of God Judas ever called Jesus Lord? Never recognized him as the Lord of his life. Judas was the son of perdition. The word perdition means he was the son of waste. Watch this. He wasted the teachings of Jesus. He wasted the miracles of Jesus. He wasted every opportunity he had to come to know Christ. Judas Iscariot around Jesus Christ, seeing all of his miracles, hearing all of his teaching, watching all he did, wasted all of them. Can I tell you tonight, and I want you to be well aware of this, that hanging around good people won't take you to heaven? Did you know you can belong to a lion's cub and not be a lion? Right? And you can belong to a Baptist church and not be saved. Right? You can be baptized and not be saved. But I want to tell you something. Here's Judas Iscariot. He heard the word of God, but he didn't become saved. He did the works. He was the treasurer of that organization, but he was not saved. He ate at the Lord's table and drank of the cup, but he'll thirst forever in hell. He kissed the door to heaven, and he went to hell. Can I just tell you tonight, you better make your calling and election sure. Better make sure you're saved tonight. And can I tell you something? There's nothing more important than knowing for sure you're going to heaven. Say what you want to. I don't care how elementary it may sound to you. There's nothing more important than knowing for sure if you die, you'd go to heaven. It's important. Let me mention just two or three more things, and I'm through tonight. Jesus not only prayed for their safety, he prayed for them. He prayed for their satisfaction. Look at verse number 13 with me, John 17, 13. And now I come to thee that these things I speak in the world, that they might have their joy fulfilled in themselves. He's talking to us about the joy of having joy in the world you and I are living in. And I'm going to tell you that I believe this with all my heart, that a Christian doesn't have to go around looking like he's been run over by a Mack truck and like his mother-in-law has come to live with him the rest of his life. Amen. If you're saved, tell your face about it. Amen. I mean, we have something to be happy about, be joyful about. I talked with three people this last week that told me they just found out they had cancer. You know what they told me? They said, preacher said, here's what they told me, all three of them. They said, I'm a winner either way. If God touches me and heals me, I'm a winner. If he doesn't, I'm going home. I'm a winner either way. And we are. Are we not? Okay. Let me mention two more things. I'm through. He prays for their sanctification. Look at verse number 17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. The power whereby God changes us from day to day as we look as a mirror in the word of God. You look in a mirror at your house. The Bible's called a mirror. You see things are wrong. You change them. And when you take a daily look in this word of God, your word is truth. You start changing your life to conform the word of God. That's our setting apart, our sanctification. And then lastly, in verse number 18 with me, please, let me look at this. As thou hast sent me into the world, even so I have sent them into the world. He prays for our service. He's praying for my service. He's praying for your service. Remember Jesus Christ met with the disciples that night after he resurrected? He says, as the Father has sent me, even so send I you into the world. We have an example of service. And everybody in this building, listen to me, everybody in this building this morning, you're the best Christian somebody knows. Is that not right? And you're serving the Lord wherever you are. You may be serving at home. You may be serving him on the job. You may be serving at school. You may be serving at church. But you're serving the Lord somewhere. It doesn't matter. You're serving the Lord. If you're teaching some football players to play ball, if you're teaching some boys or girls, you're serving somewhere in some capacity. Can I tell you that in God's work, no place is secular and no place is sacred? They're all sacred. There's no difference between them. Because, see, wherever God puts you is the place God wants you to serve and magnify him. And I want to tell you that every one of us are on heavenly business for the King. Because we're ambassadors of God. That's what you and I are. I represent Jesus Christ wherever I go. And believe it or not, you do too. Do you not? I mean, you do. I mean, you wouldn't believe how many people will say to some of you folks that sing in the choir, said, you go up to that church and I've seen you singing in the choir. Aren't you glad you didn't say something bad? Aren't you glad the blue light special you didn't do something you shouldn't have done? Amen? We're laborers together. I want you just to listen. I'm got my landing gear down. We've circled the field. We're headed down. Are you laboring in a place that's not well known tonight? Just listen. Christ is praying for your service there. Who ever heard of Nazareth till Christ showed up? Are you laboring in a job that's not attractive? Christ is praying for you there. Who ever heard of Calvary till Jesus labored there? Are you laboring with insufficient funds or income? Christ is praying for you there. Whoever heard of the widow of Zarephath till Elijah went there? Are you laboring in a place that seems not appreciated? Christ is praying for you there. Whoever heard of Martha and Mary's home till Jesus visited there? Are you laboring in a place where it seems that you're accomplishing nothing? Christ is praying for you there. Whoever heard of Nehemiah till the walls you didn't build? Does anybody remember the song, this old song? I don't think it's a religious song. I don't think it is. I've heard Brother Harvey sing it a lot, but I don't think it's a religious song. Or Brother, maybe it's Brother Smith I heard singing it. She'll be coming around the mountain. No, it's not it. That's not it. You ever heard the song, Brighten the Corner Where You Are? You know the story about the song? A woman wanted to travel around the world because she had a great voice. She wanted to sing around the world. But her father became very ill, and no one was to care for him. And she was despondent that she wanted to travel. She wanted to sing. And finally, one day, sitting at home trying to keep her father, she came up with those words. I can't travel, but I can brighten the corner where I am. And you can too. On the job, listen to me now, on the football field, on the track field, in the classroom, in the shop, on the streets, in the stores, Christ is praying for you. Listen to me now. As you teach that class, work with those children, sing that song, drive that van, play those instruments, lend your hands to the deaf, change diapers, greet folks, sing in a choir, usher, teach in the school, put Bibles together, answer a phone, visit a nursing home, witness to others, pass out tracts, pray with someone, let someone lean upon your shoulder, smile, a handshake, a cheer. Whatever you've done in His name, I want you to know He's praying for you. I want to thank the Lord that nearly 40 years, every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, almost without exception, and every Wednesday night, through the days of the week, He's been faithful. And He's helped me these years. I want to praise Him for it. And I'm glad that tonight He sits in the heaven and He's praying for me. And He's praying for you. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. You're very good people to listen. You're very kind. We're going to sing an old song that we know tonight very well, I believe. What number is it, Brother Rick? 397. Could I get you to do this tonight? If you're here and you do not know Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, could I get you tonight? If you're not sure you die, you go to heaven. I didn't ask you if you're a member of a church. I want to know if you don't know Christ tonight. He hath the Son, hath the life. Would you come and let someone take the Word of God and show you how you can be saved, how you can know it tonight? Don't leave the building without doing so. I wonder tonight, is there somebody on your heart that you need to pray for tonight? I need to pray for yourself tonight. I want you to come. Would you do that, please, tonight? If you need to pray for someone that's lost, someone in your family,
a child, a family member, someone sickly, you want to pray for them tonight, I want you to come. Dear Father, speak to our hearts to honor you and to please you. Thank you for your people. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for our young people tonight. They're special. Use them and bless them for Christ's sake. While they're playing for us, little is much when God is in it. If there's someone you want to pray for tonight, you want to pray for yourself. If you're not sure if you die, you'd go to heaven tonight. Would you let me have the privilege of taking the Word of God and show you how you can be saved, how you can know it? We'll wait just a few minutes. Somebody talk with God about tonight. Pray for someone. Pray for yourself. You come. We'll wait just a few minutes. Someone's praying for you. That first verse of that song, I think you know it well enough to sing it. Let's sing it. Let's sing the first verse, Brother Rick.
In the harvest field now ripen, there's a work for all to do. Hark, the voice of God is calling to the harvest, calling you.
Yes.
Little is much when God is in it.
Oh, labor not for wealth or fame.
There's a crown and you can win it if you go in Jesus' name.
Now, precious, we're going to stand together. Listen to me closely. If you're here, you've been saved, but you never made it public in a church service what Christ has done for you, why don't you come tonight? Or if you're here tonight and you need to be baptized, set a time to get baptized, why don't you come tonight? This is the church family you'll be a part of. You ought to come tonight. You ought to come tonight. You ought to take care of that. Let's stand together and sing that second verse. Let's stand. Let's sing it. You come.
Does the place you call to labor seem so small and little known?
You come.
It is great.
Yes.
If God is in
come on.
It, and He'll not
amen.
Forget
that's
His
right.
own.
Little is much when God is in it. Oh, labor not for wealth or fame. Oh,
there's a crown, and you can win it if you.
People said?
Amen.
Take about seven or eight people and tell them you love them before you leave, all right? Gina? Bless you. Come play the.